slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Glad to have you with us this Sunday morning, the last Sunday of August already. Next weekend will be Labor Day weekend in the park, so be sure to remember that it's 9:30 and bring your chair and your bulletin from your newsletters. that went out on Tuesday. So, thank you to all of you who participated in the Whale of a Sale. It is a huge success. Many of you brought in multiple items and they have sold, and Eddie and Christina have done a great job as chairs, and those of you who are pitching in any way, you have done a great job. So thank you so very much. Remember, on September 20th at 10:50, we come back to the United Church of Phelps with worship and in the sanctuary here, and at Junius at 9:30 that same day, we're out at the church at Junius worshiping God together. So remember to wear your mask and use hand sanitizer and social distance, and we'll all be good that we can continue on. Let us call ourselves to worship. Oops, no, let's listen to Kay play. I don't know why I always do that, but Kay. UK. And now let us call ourselves to worship. Today we come to you, God, in worship from a multitude of moments, a variety of backgrounds, all walks of life, and yet one in the Spirit. We humbly give thanks that the promises we count upon remain true today as they have for generation upon generation. Your mercies are great and everlasting, Lord. Accept our worship to you this day as an offering of our love for you. Our song is In the Bulb, There Is a Flower, and I did not bring the words to that end. Do you have that?
Yep.
Oh, I'll come visit you.
Seen an apple tree in cocoons, a hidden promise. Butterflies will soon be free in the cold and snow of winter. There's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season. Something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds, a mystery. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last a victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Papers all over the place. It's a wonderful thing to be able to come before God and to confess our sins on a regular basis, and not just at the end of life when we're sorry for the things we might have done. So let us come before God now and confess our sins together. Lord Jesus, I want to be a Christian in my heart. Please forgive my disobedience. I want to be a Christian in my actions. Please forgive my bad choices. I want to be a Christian in my words. Please forgive the mean things I say. I want to be a Christian in my whole life. Help me to be more loving to you and to others.
Amen.
These assuring words: God pardons our sin and passes over our transgressions. He does not remain angry forever, but delights in showing us his mercy. He has compassion upon us. Believe the good news that in Jesus Christ we are indeed forgiven. Amen. Well, Anthony, you said you know this song, so this isn't a new one to teach you. We should have no problems, right?
Should be okay.
Kay knows this one too, so here we go. Join us.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world.
Red and yellow,
black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Believe believe it. That's the truth. Jesus loves the little children, and if you're 102, you are still God's little child. So believe that good news also. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we are thankful for this time, wherever we are, to be able to gather and worship you, whether we are with our families, which include pets of any kind, whether we're alone with our pets or without our pets, wherever we are, whatever we're doing, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you. Open our hearts and minds to hear your word and to see how you have set up things in the past to bring forth in the future, and you continue to do those things into our futures as well. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, chapter 4 of Ruth, and I believe last week we left Ruth having been with Boaz at night on the threshing floor, and she went home, and he went home, and he was going to take care of matters that day. So we pick up this story there. Boaz went to the town gate and took a seat there. Just then the family redeemer he had mentioned came by, so Boaz called out to him, "Come over here and sit down, friend. I want to talk to you." So they sat down together. Then Boaz called 10 leaders from the town and asked them to sit as witnesses. And Boaz said to the family redeemer, "You know Naomi, who came back from Moab? She is selling the land that belonged to our relative Elimelech. I thought I should speak to you about it so that you can redeem it if you wish. If you want the land, then buy it here in the presence of these witnesses. But if you don't want it, let me know right away, because I am next in line to redeem it after you." The man replied, "All right, I'll redeem it." Then Boaz told him, "Of course, your purchase of the land from Naomi also requires that you marry Ruth, the Moabite widow. That way she can have children who will carry on her husband's name and keep the land in the family." "Oh, then I can't redeem it," the family redeemer replied, "because this might endanger my own estate. You redeem the land. I cannot do it." Now, in those days, it was the custom in Israel for anyone transferring a right of purchase to remove his sandal and hand it to the other party. This publicly validated the transaction. So the other family redeemer drew off his sandal as he said to Boaz, "You buy the land." Then Boaz said to the elders and to the crowd standing around, "You are witnesses that today I have bought from Naomi all the property of Elimelech, Chilion, and Mahlon. And with the land I have acquired Ruth, the Moabite widow of Mahlon, to be my wife. This way she can have a son to carry on the family name of her dead husband and to inherit the family property here in the hometown. You are all witnesses today." Then the elders and all the people standing at the gate replied, "We are witnesses. May the Lord make this woman who is coming into your home like Rachel and Leah, from whom all the nation of Israel descended. May you prosper in Ephrathah and be famous in Bethlehem. And may the Lord give you descendants by this young woman who will be like those of our ancestor Perez, the son of Tamar and Judah." So Boaz took Ruth into his home, and she became his wife. When he slept with her, the Lord enabled her to become pregnant, and she gave birth to a son. Then the women of the town said to Naomi, "Praise the Lord, who has now provided a redeemer for your family. May this child be famous in Israel. May he restore your youth and care for you in your old age. For he is the son of your daughter-in-law, who loves you and has been better to you than 7 sons." Naomi took the baby and cuddled him to her breast, and she cared for him as if he were her own. The neighbor women said, "Now at last Naomi has a son again." And they named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse and the grandfather of David. This is the genealogical record of their ancestor Perez. Perez was the father of Hezron. Hezron was the father of Ram. Ram was the father of Amminadab. Amminadab was the father of Nashon. Nashon was the father of Salmon. Salmon was the father of Boaz. Boaz was the father of Obed. Obed was the father of Jesse. Jesse was the father of David. Thus ends the reading of God's holy word. Thanks be to God. Okay, this story has been all over the place. We have been to foreign lands. We have returned to Bethlehem. We have been without somebody to take care of the women. We have been with somebody to take care of the women. And now finally at the end, things are finalized and settled. Boaz did indeed take care of things as he said he would. He didn't wait very long. He was right out there taking care of it. He was willing to take on the task of caring for Ruth, but also Naomi. Now, I have to back up a little bit and explain to you why that was a big deal. In those days, we talked about redeemer kinsmen before. In those days, women could not do any work to raise money and take care of themselves. They depended on their redeemer kinsmen. The redeemer kinsmen would provide for all of their needs. They didn't have to worry about a thing, nothing at all. Ruth and Naomi came back to Bethlehem without a redeemer kinsman. And if you recall, they got kind of hungry. And so that's when Ruth said, let me go out in the field and let me pick up the leftover pieces and at least feed us so we can continue on. And ended up being in the field of Boaz, who was one of the redeemer kinsmen for Elimelech, all in the family. God's hand was at work. They might not have seen God's hand at work at that point in time, but God's hand was at work. Naomi told Ruth to go and lie down at the threshing floor at the feet of Boaz, which she did. She insisted more than what Naomi had told her to do, because after all, she was not from Bethlehem. She didn't know the customs. She insisted that he become her husband and redeem her from not having children and to provide for her as well as Naomi. And he said, remember, I'll talk to the next redeemer kinsman. So that's where we've gotten in the story. If nobody had said yes, they would take care of these two women, they would have been... Ruth would be gleaning when she was 105 years old because there would be nobody else to take care of them. She would have to do it. But now, today, in today's story, interesting twist. Boaz comes to the city gates and sits down. Now, don't laugh at me if I can't get back up again. But anyway, he sits down and he's watching the people go back and forth and back and forth. And he sees that redeemer kinsman that he told Ruth about. And he says, hey, come on over here and sit down. I want to talk to you. So he comes over and has a seat. And they're just shooting the breeze, talking, very casual. Doesn't seem to be anything in particular that Boaz is doing to say, I want to talk to you about Ruth. It just kind of comes out in the conversation. Hey, did you know that Naomi is selling the land that belonged to Elimelech? And you are next in line to be the redeemer kinsman. And if you would like to buy it, by all means, I wish you would do so. Yeah, that's great. He's thinking in his mind, I can buy this land, and I have land, and I can gain, it'll be mine forever and ever, and I can gain all kinds of profit off of this piece of land by planting grain. But Boaz kind of throws a curveball in there, because the next thing out of his mouth is, but you do know that Ruth, who is the widow of one of Naomi's sons, goes in with the package here. You're not just buying the land. You're also saying you'll take care of Ruth and provide her with a son to be an heir from her dead husband. And not only that, I just want to remind you that Naomi's in the package too, and you have to take care of her as well. Well, that didn't sit very well, because suddenly that property that was going to be his and his inheritance to his own children suddenly still was Elimelech's inheritance to his grandson if Ruth should have a son. And he would have to pay not only for the land, he'd have to pay for the plowing and the seeds. He would have to pay for any needs that Naomi and Ruth might have. He would have to put out some bucks, and it could be significant bucks over the years. And where is the profit going? Not in his pockets. Because the field, if Ruth ever had a son, when he got old enough, would belong to him. So he immediately backs out of this deal in a quick and a hurry. No, 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 I don't want to have anything to do with it. It's all yours. And in the process to officially negotiate this deal, he takes his sandal off and he hands it to Boaz, saying, all right, I had opportunity, it was my opportunity, but I'm giving it to you for you to take it on. You buy the field, you marry Ruth, you take care of Naomi, life is all good. Now, remember, Boaz is pretty smart. He had called together, when this man came over to sit down, he had called together 10 leaders of Bethlehem to witness all the proceedings so that there would be no question in anyone's mind that this was binding. Now, in our time, if we were going to buy property, we would go to the lawyer and we would have the lawyer write up all this records and all this business and make sure the transaction was all legal and everything. But in those days, all it took was 10 people to witness something, and it was a done deal. It was all legal, it was all good. And so Boaz says, oh boy, thank you very much. I want to buy this land. I want to marry Ruth. She is a wonderful woman, and I will willingly take care of Naomi, her mother-in-law. Win, 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 all the way around. Boaz, as far as we can tell, was never married, never had any children, so if he had kids by Ruth, hey, that was all the better for him, right? And that land would go down the line to his own son, who was born of himself and Ruth, even though in those days that son would have been considered one of Ruth's dead husband's children. All right, so that ends that story. Ends in a happy note. It's wonderful, right? Why is it in the Bible? What's the big deal about the story of Ruth? Why do we have to know any of this? It's kind of crazy, is it not? There's not even a mention of God anywhere in this book. And yet we can see God's hand working, but there's no mention of Boaz having talked to God or asked God for advice about what he should do in this situation. None of that. Here's the reason. I kind of asked you to think about the reason last week, or I mentioned something about we would be talking about the reason for this book this week. Here's the reason: the genealogy. I don't know if you picked it up, but the genealogy goes back to Perez, and it comes all the way up to Boaz, who had Obed, and then I think there were one or two in between there, and it ends up with the birth of David, King David. King David was the one that the Messiah would be part of his family tree. So without Boaz and Ruth, where would Jesus have come on this family tree? God, even back then, was thinking about you and me, caring about us enough to say, you guys are a mess. You need to have my son come and straighten you out. And he was preparing even generations prior to Jesus' birth for Jesus to be born into this family, a people who were watching for God's hand in their midst and obedient to what God said. Wow, that's quite a story. Now, how do we apply that to today? Well, let me just try to get up off of this floor and suggest the decisions that we make today have an impact that we will never know generations down the road. If we are obedient to God and we make the decisions God wants us to make, down the road somewhere, when somebody 200, 300, 400 years, 500 years down the road looks back at their genealogy, they'll say, hey, Anthony chose to marry Carly, and because Anthony married Carly, this is how this part of the family went on. Or Kay made choices to follow God, and because Kay followed God, she had children, and they had children, and this is how her family goes on. Or the same could be for me, although I don't have kids, I have a nephew and a niece that I influenced. So, we don't know what our actions might do or lead to in the future, but I can tell you, my prayer for me and for you is that anything we do is for the glory of God, and that somewhere down the road, they may not remember Ellen's name like we remember Ruth's name and Boaz's name, but they might find that their family tree was just a little different because Ellen was part of somebody's life. So think about it as you make choices this week. Consider not just this is what I want to do today, but consider how that is going to impact the future for God and God's plan. Think about it. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we ask that you be with all those who have special need of you this day. We're mindful of the forest fires in California that are ravaging and destroying people's homes and lives. We're mindful of the hurricanes that are hitting the Gulf and will continue to hit the Gulf probably throughout this hurricane season. We're mindful of people still dealing and coping with COVID-19 and the many losses throughout our country and around the world due to COVID-19. We're mindful of folks in our congregations who have physical needs and need your healing touch. For those who need healing of mind or spirit or body, we lift them up to you and ask that you touch them in a special way. Be with those who are homeless and hungry. Be with those who have addictions. Be with those who have other special needs, and you know who they are, Lord. And be with the congregations. Help them to, whatever we do and say, give you honor and glory. Lord, hear us now as we lift our voices in the prayer which your Son Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our final song is, I know, Junia, one of Junius's favorites, and I'm assuming that some other folks here in this congregation also enjoy this song, The Old Rugged Cross.
Suffering and shame, and I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In that old rugged cross. us, stained with blood so divine. A wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. And praise God for Ruth and Boaz and Jesus Christ. Amen.